Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself, Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video, I'll be talking on otosclerosis. Otosclerosis, it is a localized disease of the bone which is derived from the otic capsule, which is characterized by the replacement of mature lamellar bone by the woven bone with greater thickness, cellularity and vascularity. Due to the alternating phases of bone resorptions and the bone formation. Otosclerosis, it is a disease of the bone which is unique to the otic capsule. This otic capsule is the bony labyrinth. From the name itself, we can make out that there is some sclerosis or the hardening of the ear bones. So this term is derived from the Greek words which means the hardening of the ear. This disease was first described in 1860 by Toynbee. The term otosclerosis was coined by Politzer in 1893. It is also known by another name called otospongiosis. The otospongiosis, the term was termed by Siebenmann. But neither this term otosclerosis or the otospongiosis is the perfect or accurate. The reason being, these two terms are referred to the different stages of the disease. The term otospongiosis is generally used for the active early phase of the disease with the active vascular focus. And the otosclerotic term is used for the late stage of the disease where the final sclerosis of the bone occurs. And this stage is the inactive stage of the lesion. These patients of otosclerosis, they usually present with the hearing loss, which is gradually progressive and which is bilateral in affection. The sites of the otosclerosis, the most common being the oval and the round window where the cartilaginous rest are found. Now let us see the epidemiology of the disease. Otosclerosis, it is the most common cause of the progressive type of the conductive hearing loss in adults. Usually the age group of the patients suffering from the otosclerosis, they are young people ranging from the second to third decade. It affects mainly the young women. If you see the female is to male ratio, the females are two times more commonly affected than the males. If we look into the racial incidence, it is more common among the Caucasians followed by the Asians. In 50% of the patients, they give a positive family history. And genetic studies reveal that it has autosomal dominant transmission of the disease. This disease is seen involving both the ears in 70 to 80% of the cases. So we know that otosclerosis, it is a disease of the bony labyrinth or the otic capsule. Before we go into the disease proper, let us see the normal structure of the labyrinth. So just for the brush up of the anatomy, the labyrinth, it is composed of two parts. One is the membranous labyrinth, which is also called as the otic labyrinth, and the bony labyrinth, which is the otic capsule. Otosclerosis, remember, it is the disease of the bony labyrinth. This membranous labyrinth, it consists of utricles, saccule, cochlea, semicircular canal, endolymphatic duct and sac. This membranous labyrinth, it contains endolymph. The membranous labyrinth is surrounded by bony labyrinth, which is called the otic capsule. This bony labyrinth, it has two layers, inner layer and the outer layer. The inner layer, which is a dense non-vascular bone, which is usually derived from the cartilaginous capsule of the otic vesicle, it provides protection to the nerve structures of the inner ear. This inner layer of the bony labyrinth is surrounded by another outer layer of the bony labyrinth. This outer layer of the bony labyrinth, the type of the bone is the lamellar bone. In between these two bony layers is located the well-demarcated lymph space. This bony labyrinth, It ossifies from the numerous centers. And when some fetal cartilage remains in some of the patients, then it becomes a potential site for the development of the otosclerotic focus. The most common site from where the otosclerotic focus is seen is the area of the fissula antefenestrum, which is located in the anterior margin of the oval window, where the stapes foot plate is located. If we look into the pathology of the disease has two stages, early stage and the late stage. In the early stage, the bone resorption occurs along with the replacement by the another new bone, which is a vascular spongy osteoid tissue. And in the late stage, the resorbed bone is replaced by the dense sclerotic bone of reduced vascularity. So in the early stage, the bone which we get in the lesion is of the increased vascularity. If you see this picture, this is a pathological picture of the early stage. Now let us see the site of otosclerosis in the temporal bone. As the bony labyrinth, it arises from the numerous centers. So any part of the labyrinth where these cartilaginous remnants may remain may be affected. So the otosclerosis can affect any part of the bony labyrinth. It is seen that in majority of the cases, around two-thirds of the cases, both the temporal bones are affected. And moreover, they bear the striking similarity in the location and the extent of the disease on the both sides. But there are certain common sites for the otosclerosis. The most common site for the otosclerosis is the anterior part of the stapedial foot plate, which is the area of the fistula antefenestrum. The second most common site for the otosclerosis is the area of the round window. When it is involved, it is called the cochlear otosclerosis. The other common sites being the area of the processus cochleiformis and the bulge of the promontory. So in majority of the cases, the otosclerotic foci, it involves the oval window or the stapedial foot plate. So depending on the location of the disease, extent of the disease, the stapedial otosclerosis is divided into different types. If you see here, this is a diagram of the normal stapes. This is the normal stapes foot plate. This is the anterior crura, posterior crura. This is the stapedius tendon. So when the lesion or the otosclerotic foci, it involves the area anterior, if it involves the anterior part of the stapes foot plate, it is called the anterior focus. If it involves the posterior part of the stapedial foot plate, it is called the posterior focus. We call the stapedial otosclerosis biscuit type when the lesion, it involves whole of the stapes foot plate, but the margins or the annular ligament of the foot plate is spared. In the circumferential type, the annular ligament is involved, the center is free, and it is called obliterative type when the whole of the stapes foot plate and the annular ligament is obliterated by the lesion. Now let us see the histopathology of the otosclerosis. So as we know that the disease has an early stage and the late stage. In the early stage, the bone resorption occurs along with the deposition of the new bone. The new bone, it has enlarged marrow spaces, which is rich in blood vessels and the connective tissue. The bone is absorbed by the osteoclast, and the new bone which is deposited, it is done by the osteocytes. So in the early stage of the disease, the bone has a typical spongy appearance, and in this stage of the disease, it is also called as the otospongiosis. Since it has a spongy appearance, the other name of the disease is otospongiosis. In the early stages, when H&E staining is done, these lesions, they assume a bluish coloration, which is called the blue mantle of Menace. If you see here, this is an example of the early lesion of the otosclerotic foci. If you see here, it is looking blue in color. So this is how the early lesions, they look like. It is called the blue mantle. In this lesions, the osteoclast will be found in the center of the lesion and the osteocytes are found at the edges of the lesions. In the late part of the disease, the foci has less vascularity and there will be more bone. And when H&E staining is done, it is stained red. And in this stage, if the lesion involves the endosteum of the cochlea, then it leads to sensorineural hearing loss. Now let us see the etiology of the otosclerosis. The exact cause of the otosclerosis is not known, but the most supportive etiology is proposed is the genetic cause. It is seen that the six different genetic loci is found to be associated with otosclerosis, and moreover, it is seen that the disease, it has a autosomal dominant type of trait. And in approximately in half of the cases, the patient, they give a positive family history of the disease. Now let us see the clinical presentation in cases of otosclerosis. The most common clinical presentation is the hearing loss or the difficulty in hearing, other being the tinnitus and sometimes the vertigo, which is an uncommon symptom. Hearing loss, it is most common presenting symptom of the disease. It is a gradually progressive type of hearing loss which develops over the period of years, and moreover, it affects both the ears in 70% of the cases. The type of loss is conductive type of loss. It is seen that the hearing loss, it comes to notice only when the patient, they develop the hearing loss of approximately 25 to 30 decibel. One characteristic of this disease is that in cases of bilateral involvement, usually the hearing loss is equal on both the sides. But sometimes in few of the cases, we may get a mixed hearing loss which occurs due to the involvement of cochlea, which further leads to the sensorineural component of the disease. Another characteristic feature we get in otosclerosis is paraacusis villosi. It is the patient, they hear better in the presence of background noise. The reason is that a normal person, when they are in noisy place, to hear in a better way, they used to raise their voice above the noise level to overcome the masking effect of the noise. And when they raise their voice, this level of speech sound is above the threshold of the patient in conductive hearing loss seen in otosclerosis. As the speech level threshold, it increases, these patients with otosclerosis with conductive hearing loss, they hear better in the background noise, and this phenomena is called paraacusis villosi. Sometimes few of the patients, they may present also with the tinnitus or some sound in the ear. The tinnitus can be present in one ear or both the ears. If tinnitus is present in a case with otosclerosis, it indicates sensorineural degeneration. And in those cases where there is no sensorineural component, it means that the disease is in the early stage, which indicates the abnormal degree of vascularity. Vertigo is an uncommon symptom which is seen in otosclerosis. Usually the speech, the type of speech of the patient with otosclerosis, they have a very typical monotonous and very soft type of speech. So we have seen that otosclerosis, it is the most common type of gradually progressive hearing loss in young adults. It affects mostly the females. But there are certain things, again, we have to see in the history, which is most important being the age. It affects the early teens or the late 30s, usually females. In history, always look for the hearing loss, the pattern of hearing loss, the bilaterality of the hearing loss. It is bilateral, gradually progressive, conductive loss. In otosclerosis, we get paraacusis villosi. In otosclerosis, we get a positive family history in approximately 50% of the patients. And lastly, these patients with conductive hearing loss, they will have a negative history for the infection or the trauma. So these are the certain points which are in favor of otosclerosis from the history point of view. So when a patient is presenting with conductive hearing loss, when we examine the ear, the tympanic membrane or the should be examined at rest, and it should be examined also with the Siegel speculum to see the mobility of the tympanic membrane. In most of the patients of otosclerosis, the tympanic membrane will be normal in color position. But in some of the cases, we may get a sign called Schwartz sign. This Schwartz sign is nothing but when we examine the tympanic membrane, a reddish hue may be seen on the promontory through the tympanic membrane. This reddish hue or the flamingo blush over the promontory, it happens due to the increased vascularity of the bone on the promontory, which is due to the active stage of the disease. So the Schwartz sign is the flamingo blush over the promontory. The name goes after this flamingo bird. When we do the tuning fork test, the Rinne's will be negative, that is the bone conduction is more than the air conduction. And when we do the Weber's test, it will be lateralized to the ear with the conductive loss. And in cases of bilateral disease, it will be lateralized to the ear with the greater degree of conductive hearing loss. Now let us see the audiological test in the otosclerosis. When we do the pure tone audiometry, we'll see that there will be a loss of air conduction, which is seen more for the lower frequencies. If you see here, this is an audiogram of a case of otosclerosis. This is a bone conduction curve. This is an air conduction curve. If you see here, there is an increase in the thresholds of the air conduction, which is mainly for the lower frequency. These are the lower frequencies. In most of the patients, the bone conduction threshold is normal. Usually, the patients, when they present with otosclerosis, they present with the mild to moderate degree of conductive hearing loss. In majority of the cases of otosclerosis, the bone conduction is normal. But in some of the cases, we may get a dip in the bone conduction curve. This dip in the bone conduction curve, it is different at different frequencies, but it is most commonly seen at 2000 Hz. This dip at 2000 Hz in the bone conduction curve with the normal bone conduction threshold is called the Cahat's notch. And this Cahat's notch is very much characteristic of otosclerosis. So if you see here this audiogram, this is the air conduction threshold, which is raised for the lower frequency. If you see here in the bone conduction curve, there is a dip at the 2000 Hz. This characteristic dip in the bone conduction is called the Cahat's notch. It is seen that this Cahat's notch, it disappears after successful stapedotomy. When we do the speech audiometry in otosclerosis, it reveals normal discrimination score, except in cases with the cochlear otosclerosis. In otosclerosis, in the early part of the disease, when we do the tympanometry, it may be normal in the early cases. But in the later part of the disease, when the stapes foot plate, it becomes fixed, then we may get AS type of curve. AS type, the S stands for steep. So if you see here in otosclerosis, this AS type is very representative of otosclerosis, which signifies the abnormal stiffness in the middle ear system. There will be, in the AS type of curve, we get a reduced peak. That means the resistance is high and the admittance values are very low. The middle ear pressure will be normal, and the acoustic reflex, when we do tympanometry, we measure the acoustic reflex, which is a sensitive measure of the stapes mobility. In otosclerosis, the acoustic reflex is absent. So this is a electronic generated tympanogram of the otosclerosis patient. If you see here, this is a AS type of curve with a reduced peak, which means increased resistance or the stiffness of the middle ear system. So in otosclerosis, we get conductive type of hearing loss. So there are certain differential diagnoses which should be kept in mind. So the differential diagnosis of otosclerosis, we have divided into two groups. First is the middle ear lesions and the malleus and incus lesions. In the middle ear lesions, the differential diagnosis we have to keep in mind is the being the otitis media with effusion, adhesive otitis media, tympanosclerosis, congenital footplate fixation, and ossicular discontinuity. Under the group of malleus and incus lesions, some of the conditions which should be kept in mind are the fixed malleus and incus syndrome, congenital cholesteatoma, persistent stapedial artery, Paget's disease, and osteogenesis imperfecta. In otosclerosis, when we get a sensory neural deafness, it means that the cochlea is involved by the otosclerotic foci. So the sensory neural deafness can occur due to the bony invasion of the scalar tympani of the cochlea. It can also occur due to the circulatory changes in the cochlea as a result of abnormal bony foci, or due to the damage by the toxic metabolites from the abnormal bone. Radiology doesn't play a much role in otosclerosis, but in HRCT of the temporal bone sometimes can be done, which helps to identify the sclerotic lesions. In the management of the otosclerosis, it is divided into two parts. One first is the medical management and other is the surgical management. The medical management, it remains controversial. This medical management, it aims at maturing the involved bone and decreasing the osteoclastic activity. The molecules which are used in the medical management of otosclerosis are sodium fluoride. The sodium fluoride, it was first introduced by Shambo and Scott. The sodium fluoride, it reduces the osteoclastic bone resorption and it increases the osteoblastic bone formation. The indications for prescribing sodium fluoride in otosclerosis are in surgically confirmed otosclerosis with progressive sensory neural loss, in patients with positive Schwartz sign, in patients with pure sensory neural loss whose family history, age of onset, and the audiometric pattern is suggestive of cochlear otosclerosis. Another molecule which is of future hope in cases of otosclerosis is the biphosphonates. This biphosphonates, it inhibits the osteoclastic activity. And lastly, in the medical management, the hearing aid, it plays a non-surgical method of managing the hearing loss in otosclerosis. Moreover, those patients who refuse surgery or who are unfit for surgery can use the hearing aids. The surgical management of otosclerosis, there are two different type of surgeries. One is stapedectomy, where the whole of the foot plate is removed, and the stapedotomy, where a fenestra is made in the stapes foot plate. The goal of the surgery in otosclerosis is the restoration of the sound transmission mechanism from the tympanic membrane through the ossicular chain to the oval window membrane, bypassing the resistance of the fixed stapes foot plate caused due to the otosclerotic foci. The indications for the surgery being a patient with otosclerosis and a bone conduction level of 0 to 25 dB in the speech range and an ear conduction of 45 to 60 decibel is a suitable candidate for surgery. Moreover, the ear bone gap should be at least 15 dB and the speech discrimination score or the SDS should be more than 60%. So these are the indications for the surgery. There are certain contraindications to the surgery. Let us see one by one. So surgery is contraindicated in general when a patient is suffering from a general medical condition that makes the patient unfit for the surgery, If a patient is an elderly patient, more than 70 years of age, in conductive loss from other causes, in the presence of otitis externa or the tympanic membrane perforation, the surgery cannot be done. Moreover, when the otosclerosis, it involves the one side or it is the only hearing ear, then the surgery is contraindicated. Moreover, in cases of stapedial and cochlear otosclerosis with the poor ear bone gap. So remember, the ear bone gap should be at least 15 decibel. During pregnancy time, it should be delayed till the childbirth. In cases of vertigo, the surgery should not be done. And in early fixations with very small degree of hearing loss, it is not advised to do the surgeries. Lastly, in certain group of people with occupations which demand considerable physical strain, like people who are professional athletes, divers, or air travelers, since there is a risk of development of perilymph fistula, the surgery is contraindicated in these group of people. Now let us see in short the steps of the surgery. The surgery can be done by both under low general or the local anesthesia, but the local anesthesia is usually preferred as the awake patient can inform about the vertigo if it occurs, and secondly, it reduces the risk and the cost of the general anesthesia, and if a surgery is done under the local anesthesia, the duration of the surgery becomes short. Now coming to the steps of the surgery, the first is the infiltration of the local anesthesia into the ear canal. Once the local anesthesia is infiltrated, the incision is made over the posterior canal wall and the tympanometal flap is elevated. So if you see here, this is the canal wall, this is the tympanometal flap which is elevated. That means the tympanic membrane and a part of the posterior canal wall is elevated and it is reflected anteriorly. When the flap is elevated, it should be elevated up to the short process of the malleus for the adequate exposure. When the flap is elevated, usually stapes is not in view due to the posterior superior bony canal overhang. So if you see here, this is the tympanometal flap. This is the inguinostapedial joint. This is the stapes. If you see here, this is the stapes bone which is resting on the stapes foot plate, and this is the stapedius tendon. So as once the tympanometal flap is elevated, to make the stapes into view, the scutum must be removed. So the scutum is removed by either curette or the micro drill. And after the stapes comes into view, the ossicles are palpated to assess the mobility. And the distance between this incus and the stapes foot plate, this distance is measured because after the fenestra is made in the stapes foot plate, one prosthesis has to be put. So once the scutum is removed, this inguinostapedial joint, this is the inguinostapedial joint, it is separated. Next, this is the stapedius tendon. The stapedius tendon is cut and the stapes suprastructure is fractured. So if you see here, here the stapedial tendon is cut, we cannot see the stapedial suprastructures, and which is followed by a making of a fenestra in the stapes foot plate. So if you see here, this is the stapes suprastructures, it is removed and a fenestra is made here. Now, after the fenestra is made, the prosthesis is placed in the fenestra with crimping to the incus. So this is how a prosthesis is placed into the fenestra and it is being crimped to the incus bone. And when the whole of the stapes foot plate is removed, it is called stapedectomy. When this fenestra followed by this prosthesis insertion is done, it is called stapedotomy. The stapes prosthesis which is used during the stapedotomy, they can be of very variety of shapes and they can be made from the different materials. So this is just given to show you the different shapes of the prosthesis and the different materials. It could be a Teflon piston, it could be a platinum piston or the titanium Teflon prosthesis. In the post-op period following surgeries, the patient, they are advised to keep the head and side elevated, to follow the light physical activity for the next couple of weeks. They are advised to avoid straining during defecation and to avoid the forceful nose blowing. And if there is any vertigo in the post-op period, it is managed with medications. The complications following stapedectomy, they are divided into two groups, immediate and delayed complications. So immediate complications following the surgery, it could be facial nerve injury, vertigo, hearing loss, and the persistent post-operative perilymphatic fistula from the oval window. There are certain delayed complications of the surgery, like fistula formation, granuloma formation, and prosthesis dislocation. With this, I come to an end of this video. Thank you for watching this video.